Hallo, assalamu alaikum, good morning, khush aamdeed, ji ayanu, goeiemorgen, ish pata.
Begheer agale, di hao, chura shubme, washmale, ohaya, gzaimes, gutemogen, hola, bonjour, privet, kaifahal, harishuma chatore, ahlan wasalan, marhaba, buna, mucho, gracias, suabia, balli kere aya, and thank you very much everybody for tuning in to PTB World. You're definitely watching World this morning, along to the very fantastic, very stunning, very amazing, the very handsome, Shahzad Hasan Khan, and the very superb, the very exuberant, the very excited, Miss Shiza Hashmi. Hello, Shiza. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for asking. And you guys, before we move any forward, this is the voice, the tone, the energy in the face of a sick person.
Yeah.
Imagine.
I'm trying hard.
Well, we first of all get well soon. We do
Thank
know
you very
that
much.
You are definitely not feeling well. But the thing is, I absolutely have to, you know, credit's due where it's due, absolutely have to admire it as well and commend it as well.
Okay.
Because we do know you weren't feeling well to even appear on the show. And mm-hmm. as soon as the time was coming nearer, you're doing brilliant, mashallah.
Thank you very much.
So well. That is great. So what are your plans for today, other than resting?
Well, you know, my plan for today is that, you know, as soon as I get done with the show, I really need to go rush to the doctor and mm-hmm. I really need to get my ear checked. So, ladies and gentlemen, you know, she has said that I wasn't feeling well. So I have been feeling as if, you know, I cannot hear people on my right very properly.
Okay.
And then all of a sudden, when I woke up today, it yeah. was hurting as well. So I was like, hey, you know what? I really need to kind of go to the doctor, because, you know, we have done so many shows where there was this amazing guest and she was a doctor and she said that how antibiotics are not really good for our health.
Yeah.
So I never wanted to kind of opt for antibiotics by
That's
my own
good.
Self. So
yeah.
I was like, hey, you know what? I should rather go to the doctor, get it checked, and if that's the last resort, obviously there's no other option. So I'll have to go through it, because now it has started to hurt this much that I cannot even put the earpiece in my ear.
Hmm.
But other than that, I'm perfectly fine. And yes, obviously, when you get so much love from the audiences out there, you know, you really want to kind of wake up, dress up, and show up. That's the rule. So I did show up, but I never had this energy just before we went on air.
Well,
what about you?
What's
your plan for today?
My plan for today, I'll tell you what. Ever since I woke up, my phone, my family group, my friends group, everything has been sort of, it's so rushed.
Don't give it away. Why?
It is actually,
okay.
It is actually, all right, I think we need to talk about it, Shahzad, because...
But, you know, it's the story is on number two. So first, we really need to kind of do justice with Pakistan Super League and
all
then
right,
move on
so
to the second story.
You update me what happened yesterday?
All right, so we will be updating. So ladies and gentlemen, Pakistan Super League, obviously this time around, the entertainment part is actually have been going on.
Hmm.
And that too in Qaddafi Stadium, Lahore. And just yesterday, ladies and gentlemen, Peshawar Zalmi scored 185.
Wow.
For the loss of 7 wickets, where Shoaib Malik chipped in a 58 of 41 and Hussain Talat a 51 of 33. And talking about Quetta Gladiators, Will Smead was back and he scored a staggering 99 of 60 deliveries. And Sarfaraz Ahmed, 25 of 21. I don't know. Well, Sarfaraz Ahmed had been performing in the previous matches, but on this one, I think he could have done better. But talking about the bowling, I think Usman Qadir did a wonderful job with 3 wickets for 25 runs. And Salman Rashad with 2 wickets on 37 runs as well, which I believe is a little on the higher end as well.
Mm-hmm.
But let's talk about Naseem Shah from Quetta Gladiator. What a young stunner he himself is. Taking away 4 wickets and giving in only 27 runs. And Iftikhar Ahmed taking 1 wicket and only giving away 2 runs. But ladies and gentlemen, to be very honest, Peshawar Zalmi sealed the deal against Quetta Gladiators. So for Will Smead to put in 99 for 60 or Naseem Shah to take 4 wickets off 27, that didn't do anything. And I believe that since Quetta is actually quite nearer to Karachi, and we do say that, you know, thandi hamai Balochistan se Karachi chali jati hai. We want to take a good look at the points table. Multan Sultans on top, Lahore Qalandars on number 2,
Islamabad United
on number 3, Peshawar Zalmi on number 4.
And Quetta Gladiators.
And Quetta Gladiators and Karachi Kings, obviously. So that's what I was saying. So now what we really need to kind of look over here is at the net run rates, because the net run rates will definitely have a lot of impact in the few matches to come. Because let's talk about points, where Multan Sultan still leading. That too, after losing the match at 12 points, Lahore Qalandars with 10, Islamabad United with 8, Peshawar Zalmi with 8, and Quetta Gladiators with 6, and Karachi Kings with 0, obviously, because they didn't really win a match. And Quetta Gladiators and Karachi Kings, where I was saying, are together in the points table, is because of the fact that Quetta and Karachi are even closer. So they thought, hey, you know what, let's just perform the way everybody else has been performing. So for them, Karachi was the nearest, and that's what they want to do. Well, I mean, let's see. But, you know, cricket is a funny game. Anything can happen. Let's see what's going to happen today.
I swear, one day you're telling me one thing, and the next day the entire table has changed. So fingers crossed for whatever happens as well.
True.
But thank you for updating
us, Shazad.
I feel like now we need to get to the part where...
I will.
Okay.
Yeah, because, so what happens is that, you know, so alhamdulillah, when you have like three or four cars at home, so you will never ever...
Oh, you are the appropriate person to talk about
it. Yeah, and that's what I'm going to talk about. So, you know, what happens is that, you know, it's not always a constant struggle in between me or my father that who's going to put in fuel.
Okay.
Because so whoever is driving, you know, this is one thing which our father has taught that, you know, that, okay, go ahead, you know, put in fuel so that the next person, whoever comes in, should actually have sufficient fuel to go to the petrol pump. But I think with the price hike in the petrol, well, I don't think I'll be doing that. So, you know, earlier for instance, you know, if I was, you know, fueling my car and it used to only cost me 8,000 or 9,000 rupees to fill it up to the maximum. Just yesterday, I gave them 9,000 rupees and I was like, hey, you know what, just pour whatever you can. And it didn't even come up to the maximum.
Well, it's insane. I'll tell you why, Shazad. Because the federal government increased the price of petroleum products by up to rupees 12.
Whoa!
The finance division issued the notification and the new rates will be effective from today. The notification said the prices of petroleum products jacked up due to drastic increase in petroleum prices in international market. Well, we need to sort of, you know, educate ourselves about that as well. But it was also said that Prime Minister Imran Khan had deferred the last review of the petroleum products prices on January 31st to provide the utmost relief to the consumers. But now we see the hike as well. The government levied 0% sales tax and reduced petroleum levy rates against the budgeted targets, the finance division had said. Well, for all the people who are sad about it, I'm one of you guys. Don't worry too much. I think from now on, I'm not going to even offer my husband to fuel up his car.
He can
do it by himself.
But did you use it?
I always offered, of course.
Wow.
Because the two of us were using it, right? But now it's your job.
Did
it's
he
not
always accept your offer?
Not always. Whenever he had to, he did, of course.
Well, that's great. Yeah, I mean, this is the point where, ladies and gentlemen, everybody needs to kind of contribute towards your cars and their fueling as well, because, you know, it certainly does not look like as if it's going to be one man's job. But to be honest, I think Prime Minister Imran Khan did a great job when, you know, the last month he actually did review and he was like, hey, you know what, that's going to be quite a burden for the entire population of country. So I think that, you know, this was inevitable. And since the petroleum prices are spiking in the international market as well, for any country to kind of control it, it will be inevitable.
Absolutely. But don't worry, you guys. I do realize we started with the bad news, but not everything's that bad.
Yeah.
To sort of lift up your mood, we have someone so special for this segment.
Yeah.
He's the heartthrob of everyone in Pakistan, especially ever since Pakistani dramas came into being as well, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to say something
about
it?
Yeah, what I wanted to say was in relation to, you know, where we were talking about the price hike.
Okay.
Because just 2 years ago when I was in England, I still remember that I actually fueled up my car and it costed me £80, which when I come to think now, is going to cost me somewhere around 16,000 rupees. So, you know, even in all of those developed countries, ladies and gentlemen, the petrol or the fuel prices are quite high. And alhamdulillah, we have been enjoying the lower prices for a longer period of time. I think it's all going to come down to how the rupee has been devalued in the international market because of whatever trade deficits or whatever other issues there might probably be. But inshallah, in days to come, we will see that the prices are going to come down. Now coming down towards the heartthrob.
Yes,
he's always been the heartthrob.
And our favorite as well. I do remember we've done one or two shows with him before too.
Yeah.
Always a splendid guest, always very well spoken. But without, I mean, there's so much to say about him.
Yeah.
But just in two words, I think we can definitely give a lot away. Alpha Bravo Charlie, Ede Wafa, ladies and gentlemen, he is the heartthrob we've been talking about, one of the very special stars and actors of Pakistan. Now, I want to say a businessman as well, because he has sort of made acting his part-time career. He's not doing that a lot of it now. Ladies and gentlemen, he's on Skype online with us right now, Faraz Inam Saab. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Well This Morning again.
Good morning.
Wa alaikum assalam. How are you all?
Wow, I mean, you know, now, alhamdulillah, we're doing wonderfully well, and we hope and pray that you're doing wonderfully well as well. But to be very honest, now when I saw you on television, I thought that I was watching Ehde Wafa again. You look so stunning and amazing.
Always.
And that too, you know, so are you in conversation with us from Canada or from Pakistan? Tell us that.
Very very much from Canada right now. And thank you very much for all the lovely compliments. You guys certainly know how to make my day. So thank you very much. And the wishes are and compliments are reciprocated.
Wow. Thank you very much for doing that. And you know what? You have been making so many people's day. I mean, I certainly wanted to be gender specific over here, but then I was like, okay, you know, let's not do that. But every time we look at you, we're like, we're in an awe. We're like, you know, you happen to be such a humble, modest guy, then at the same time, tall, handsome, stunning, well-spoken, well-educated, and you have stolen the hearts of the entire population of Pakistan. How do you do it, Mr. Faraz Inam? Tell me that.
Well, again, thank you very much for all the kind words. I think it is the kindness in you and the nicety around which kind of sees the good in me, because I believe I'm just a regular guy who's just leading a normal life, regular life, and it's just your greatness and your kindness which keeps me in limelight one way or the other and refuses to let this dinosaur go extinct.
Marshall, and you truly deserve that. And you know where you said that you're an ordinary guy? That's exactly how I feel when I'm in conversation with my wife.
Well, that's a secret.
How
right?
do you feel when you're in conversation with your wife?
Well, she's the love of my life. She's my boss as well. So, I mean, she brings out the best in me. That's all I can say. Yeah.
That's brilliant, and that's great to hear as well. While Farasa, we definitely want you to let us know about what is in the pipeline in terms of your future projects as well. I want to talk about the app that we last spoke about. Yep. You were building, and which was brilliant, to be honest, the platform that you created. It was a bridging, it was bridging the gap between anyone who wanted to be a part of the media industry, and especially the young aspirants who wanted to be somehow be introduced to the industry as well. Let us know how that's going, and how has the response been so far?
Yeah, the response has been wonderful, especially from the aspiring and budding media professionals, be they wannabe actors, actresses, or even, you know, people behind the camera. So the response has been very good. And I've been invited to do roadshows in Pakistan with a few, you know, institutes as well as dramatic institutes and art institutes as well. So we're just planning right now when is the right time to come, because we were also waiting for the COVID thing to, you know, pass away, because right now with all these restrictions, travel restrictions and these protocols, it kind of puts a dampener on the roadshow that we were planning. But in hopefully months to come, you will be hearing more about it from Pakistan itself. So I'm planning to, you know, make a visit and promote that in Pakistan.
Brilliant. Well, best of luck for that. Of course, we can't wait to hear about it. But, you know, this is what I was going to ask next as well. I'll still ask anyway. A lot of, you know, huge actors actually, after a few years of working as well, they want to train upcoming actors. Maybe like a masterclass or something, maybe like an entire course or something. Do you plan on doing that?
Well, honestly, Shiza, I've never considered myself to be a good actor or, you know, a person who can then impart this teaching to the others. I'm, again, consider myself lucky that because of my Air Force and military background, I was offered the role of a cadet in Sunaridin, which kind of, you know, progressed into Alpha Bravo Charlie, and which then progressed into Ahde Wafa, my role in Ahde Wafa. So while I, you know, I'm very grateful to the people, to the ISPR, and for the latest production house who kind of remembered me and invited me to revive the role of Captain Faraz, now General Faraz. But otherwise, I do not consider myself to be an actor of that level or caliber where I should be imparting, you know, training or acting lessons to others. But having said that, we are planning to promote our No One to One online media platform. And through that, we are trying to, or we are planning to invite other more established actors and actresses in Pakistan who can come and be a part of that. So there are a lot of things in the work. We just hope and pray that it becomes a success that we are envisioning it to be. And for that, we will also require your, you know, blessings and your support.
Inshallah, sir, and they will always be with you no matter what happens, because the kind of childhood you've given us, with the kind of talent you possessed, I believe that every person over here in Pakistan, first of all, believes that you have been serving the Pakistan Army for the longest period of time, that now you've been promoted to being a general as well. You know, even kids at my house, they still think that you have been serving the Pakistan Army for the longest period of time. And you know, one of them has actually even asked me, ki sir ne retire kab hona, you know, so I was like, hey, you know what, it was just a part of that. But sir, coming back to the platform where we obviously wanted to kind of have such a platform over here in Pakistan, where people who wish to, who are budding artists as well. But now when we talk about such platforms, I think what there is still a little gap, because a lot of people who might be writing to you, who might be trying to contact you, there needs to be a portal where they actually get an instant reply as well. So what are you doing on that, that for all of those people who are uploading their profiles, their pictures, who want to be on your platform, how are they being entertained from your perspective or from your end?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. And I must reply to that, because the general impression and the general feeling that I believe people are getting from it is that perhaps we have a media recruitment agency or something where we will be ourselves, selecting or shortlisting or reviewing their resumes, so to say. But in fact, let me please clarify this, that is not the case. We have tried to make it like a LinkedIn of the media world, where we expect the producers, the production houses, and all to be there looking for fresh talent. And as soon as the portal, reaches a certain level of, candidates or applicants or members in that, then the media houses will start taking this portal very seriously. Because in my very first presentation, I had requested the aspiring, budding, as well as established media professionals that we need to increase the size of the membership of this portal so that the big media houses start taking it very seriously. Mm-hmm. Because of the COVID challenges and also the travel restrictions and all that, for now we have not reached that mass, that particular mass, which which would have attracted the attention of the media houses. So we are getting there, and I'm very hopeful that in time to come, with some more effort, we will get there where then the members of No121 portal will start getting the attention that they deserve. So it's not us who are a recruitment agency. It will be producers who will be looking into the media portal once it reaches a critical mass.
Okay, so I got the point. So what you're trying to explain over here is that your platform will actually have profiles or data of people who want to work within the industry, may them be producers, singers, artists, anywhere from any walk of life where it comes down to performing arts as well. And, if there's a production house who's looking for talented people, so they can come to you and they will get all the data and they can shortlist. That's wonderful. But now, sir, there comes another important aspect to it. And that important aspect is that all of that information related to one man, girl, boy, or whosoever it is, does not fall into the hands of people who might just be pretending to have a production house and, God forbid, use that information other way around. And, God forbid, unfortunately, we have seen, it's my 12th year within the industry, that people do use such information, or the newcomers, and take advantage of that as well. So how do you protect all of that information from such agencies or production houses or people who you think can, God forbid, misuse? Is there any background check for that as well?
Yeah, another very good question, and I wanted to reply to this as well. So it is, I would say it is dependent on the member, how much of the information he or she wants to release on that portal. So if they want to, increase their privacy on that, and they want to restrict the information, their information, they can do that. And once they are approached by a production house, they have their, ways to check the authenticity of that production house before, opening up themselves to such production houses. So yes, there are privacy levels incorporated in that. And while we also have kind of, reviewing authority, but with the numbers increasing, I will honestly say that they may not be able to check each and every such a production house, eyeing for talent over there. So My suggestion would be for people to be a bit more vigilant, just the way they are on other social media sites. They need to be vigilant on that and be careful about what they put, how much of the information they put, and maintain the privacy on that as well.
Well, wonderful. Brilliant. And this really sounds great. Last time we said the same thing as well. And we hope, while inshallah, when it's on track as well, international media houses like probably Netflix gets a chance to see Pakistan's talent and hire us too. But Shahzad, I know you have a lot of questions.
Yeah.
Let's hold on to that thought for just 1 minute. I want to share a few clips of your brilliant work, Mr. Faraz, with our audiences right now. Let's take a look at them and then we'll be in conversation with you again.
Let's do that.
लगा रहा है तू शेफ के साथ दूसरी खाल नीचे से निकालने का रहता है क्या लड़ी हेल आज चौथे दिन है और मुझे तेरी मिन्नतें करनी पड़ी हैं शेफ के लिए
बटालियन सीनियर अंडर ऑफिसर फ्रेंड्स
चलो
दो साल आपने हमारे ऊपर बहुत मेहनत की है
अगर मैं मेहनत न करता तो आज आप ये तलवार कहाँ से लेते
सर हम सब सफीर के कोर्समेट्स हैं सर और सर हम सब की आपसे ये रिक्वेस्ट है कि आप प्लीज उसके केस में हमदर्दाना गौर करें सर प्लीज सर
मेरे अब्बा ने देख लिया ना कि तू इन बालों पे इतने शौक से कंघी करता है तो कल ही फौज में टेंडों के ऑर्डर हो जाएंगे
मुझे तो समझ नहीं आती कि कब तक ताने पड़ते रहेंगे हमें तेरे अब्बा की जर्नैली के और मेरी गाड़ी के
ओ छोड़ यार जेलस लोग हैं
साद चाहे मैं जितना ही बड़ा अफसर बन जाऊं मैं इस एकेडमी में गुजारे हुए वो सुनहरे दिन नहीं भूल सकता आई एम प्राउड टू से दैट आई एम अ प्रोडक्ट ऑफ दिस प्रेस्टिजियस एकेडमी
यार कितनी देर लगा रहा है तू शेफ के साथ दूसरी खाल नीचे से
Wow, I mean, it was definitely a journey down the memory lane as well. But, you
so
know,
sweet.
When we talk about Ehd-e Wafa, obviously that was just around the corner as well. But sir, towards the end, there's only one last question which I need to ask from you. Are you still with us?
Oh, yes, I'm very much there.
Yes,
and
okay.
You just, you know, took me through 30 years of journey in, say, 3 minutes. Thank you for that.
And it was wonderful. Do you still brush your hair with the same passion?
I still do. And this time, my wife, she laughs at me and says that, you know, give your hair some rest now. They're not there anymore.
That's wonderful. Sir, towards the end, first, obviously, we want you to kind of put away all the information of that application. We have been talking about how people can become a member, if there's any fee or not. And do you think that all of those people who are actually interested to work or probably upload their profiles can be contacted by all the international media agencies or media houses as well? Or is it just Pakistan-centric?
See, our eventual aim and objective is to make it so big and make it so prominent that the international media houses start taking it seriously. What I feel sitting in Canada right now is that there is a huge market and huge international market for talent from Pakistan, and there is no dearth of talent in Pakistan. It's just a matter of projecting it in the right way and bringing it to the fore, to the international arena. So my request to the budding, aspiring, as well as established media professionals in Pakistan is that here is a platform, no121.com. Here is a platform which, if they become part of and we reach a critical mass, then, you know, sky is the limit. So in the success of this portal lies their success, and their success lies in the success of the portal. So it's a you know, two-way street over here. So my request to all is that make it a success by enrolling in it, creating that critical mass so that it starts getting the attention that it deserves, not just locally, but in the international arena out there.
Inshallah.
Inshallah, definitely. So thank you so much, Mr. Faraz Anam, for being with us. It's always, always lovely to be in conversation with you.
Pleasure is mine. Thank you very much.
It's definitely
much.
Our pleasure. But ladies and gentlemen, on this note, we are headed out to short break.
Okay.
But one thing, you know, when we were talking about the petroleum product price hike, while it is going to be an issue for a lot of people, Shahzad, we have to realize that the entire population of Pakistan, 35% of the entire population lives below the poverty line.
Yep.
So while this might be an issue for some, there are a lot of other reasons that life can be problematic for those people living below the poverty line, the 35% or even more than that, because we don't know when the latest stats came in. It was in 2018 as well. So the amount of people who are going through hard things, and the hardest of all those things while living below the poverty line, is not having a shelter, I mean, on your head, not having a home to yourself. Exactly. Your home is not just a place to stay in, Shahzad, but also your identity, your confidence, your esteem, and your name as well.
And you know what? Thank you very much for saying that, because as soon as I pull outside my house, you know, it just gives me a very mesmerizing sort of a feeling. It gives me a feeling of comfort. It gives me a feeling of being home.
Definitely.
It gives me a feeling of where my parents are. And imagine that, you know, for a lot of people over here in Pakistan, ladies and gentlemen, even though now, alhamdulillah, we're very thankful to Prime Minister Imran Khan for all the Ehsaas programs which are going on. But there are a lot of other people who are doing quite a lot for all of those. I mean, I certainly don't want to say it, but people who do not have a shelter to themselves and are actually kind of forced to sleep on roads, footpaths, or wherever they find a place, and that too in such cold weather. So what are we doing in order to curtail to their needs, ladies and gentlemen? It's something we will be talking about after a short break. Don't go anywhere. We will be right back.
Stay tuned.
Life, perspective is everything. It's perspective that makes you to see through.
Capable team of handling every situation effectively.
We dream, we make a difference, and we practice the change.
We are the face of Pakistan. We have an eye over all the global issues.
We see the world from different perspectives and angles.
We have a reach that goes beyond the borders. We are PTV World.
Thank you.
All right, people, welcome back. Thank you very much for staying tuned to PTV World. You're definitely watching World This Morning alongside Shiza Hashmi, Shahzad Asad Khan. Earlier, we were in conversation with one of our most amazing actors all the way from Canada, and he happens to be Mr. Faraz Anam. Well, for all of those people who are still thinking that he served Pakistan Army, no, he didn't. His father did serve Air Force, and he only served ISBR, where he was supposed to play a character, and that too, alhamdulillah. Imagine that you pick up on a character which is going to take you 20 years down the line, and then you mature, and then all of a sudden you're a general.
Mashallah.
Wow, that's wonderful. Yeah, no?
So much fun, right?
Yeah.
But all right, now coming down to what we're going to talk about in this segment, and we did do a little recap before the break as well. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be discussing the massive issue of homelessness in Pakistan, where a lot of people, while they are definitely living below the poverty line, do not even have shelters on their head. And the worst part is, Shahzad, when we talk about vulnerability in terms of homelessness, women and children, a data says so, are mostly affected by it. Because of course, while men might find means of staying with a relative, a friend or whatsoever, or even sharing a public space with other men, women and children cannot do that.
Yes.
So the bigger issue right now over here, I feel like, Shahzad, is the children who are orphaned, who don't have guardians for that matter, who don't have family to go to for that matter, and are on the streets. They're a huge number. We have a small report for you to check out. Take a look at it. When we come back, we'll discuss the issue at hand.
Among all the sacred places on earth, the most sacred is the heart of a child. SOS Children's Village is a founded in 1946 by an Austrian, Hermann Meiner. SOS Children's Village today is the largest child welfare organization in the world, with over 1,800 projects in 132 countries. Providing a loving home to 80,000 children to have their family care for them until they are independent. The SOS philosophy is based on four principles: a mother, brothers and sisters, home, village. SOS mothers are selected with great care. They're usually single women, often widows, without their own families. They must be able to commit themselves completely to the responsibility of being the axis of an SOS home. Good education is the greatest gift to our children. Every SOS village has a school attached to it. The school provides quality education not only to SOS village children, but also underprivileged children of the area. Began as tragedy, are given a happy ending.
Well, this was really moving, of course, and this is what we are going to talk about. Organizations like SOS Village, and SOS Village in particular, what they are doing for the children of Pakistan, the orphaned and the abandoned. And to talk about that, we have someone really appropriate in the studio.
Exactly. So without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, we're very lucky that we've actually been joined by the National Director of SOS Children's Villages in Pakistan, and she happens to be Ms. Saba Faisal. Hello, assalamu alaikum, good morning, how are you?
Thank you so much for having me on the show. I'm wonderful. And it's a privilege to be here and talk about the cause which SOS is taking out.
Thank you very much that you think like that, that it's actually a privilege. But over here, what we think on PTV World or at PTV World, that it's solely our responsibility to make sure that we highlight all of those individuals within the society who've done quite a lot for the other people.
Thank you.
And you know, the four core values, I want to kind of come down to that as well. And before we kind of talk about that, ladies and gentlemen, we always see in films where, you know, there's an abandoned guy on an abandoned island and he kind of writes SOS. So SOS stands for Save Our Souls. And that's really very important for everybody to kind of understand. So if you're in emergency, make sure that you write that somewhere. But now talking about the four values, mother,
yes,
brothers and sisters, education, obviously, and then
the village.
The village.
Ji.
Now, let's start from the mother and brother and sister. That's something which we do kind of understand. Right. But what's with the village?
So basically, our motto is to provide a loving home for every child.
True.
So when you talk about a loving home, it's like a loving home for like we have in our lives, where there is the head of household, where there are other siblings.
Warm hugs.
Exactly. And it's a unit. It's a family unit. So when we talk about a village there's a saying that it takes a village to raise a child.
Yeah.
So our concept is based on that, and in our compound there are about 10 to 15 unit houses.
Wow.
Which comprise of that village.
Okay.
Basically, so that means that the children are interacting with each other. The houses next door, you know, they are the neighbors, so the children come and play with each other. So it's that concept.
Wow.
Of, you know, giving back, of a community. That's what we are.
And it's beautiful.
Sort of hoping.
But that's absolutely beautiful and really, really moving. Again, I'm going to use the word yes, because you're developing a community, not only providing them with a roof on their heads as well.
That's right.
I do remember as a university student, when we had to cover our community service hours, we often did go to and planned on going to SOS as well. Now, ma'am, being the country director, first of all, I want you to quickly sort of let us know what falls under your jurisdiction.
Right,
that's the right word as well.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, go on first and then we'll move.
Okay.
On.
So basically, as the national director, I am sitting in the national office, which is based in Lahore.
Mm-hmm.
And my job is to coordinate, communicate all the policies and procedures which we are formulating at the national office.
Right.
Our president also comes to the national office. We have all our trainings coordinated from there, donor liaison, marketing, media, everything, financial budgeting, everything is done and coordinated through the national office, and I am basically looking after all those operations, and of course including the 17 different projects all over the country.
Wow.
Brilliant, brilliant. And how often does it happen, or is it even possible that you get to hear, without even a middle party, you get to hear the grievances of people living in the SOS village, the children and the mothers for that matter, and how do you cater to them? I'll tell you why I'm asking it. Because with non-profit organizations and NGOs and similar things, Shazad, the issue that we have is you only need to be a part of it if you feel deeply about
right.
it. True. We don't need someone looking for a job. We don't need to employ someone for that. You really need to feel something about it. How do you feel this resonates with you, the cause?
So, first of all, when I joined about 5 years ago, this is my sixth year,
okay.
I had never worked in the non-government sector, and especially for such a noble and social cause. Of course, being a mother, it's a different story. I remember my first day, and I was very warmly welcomed into the SOS family. And because the national office is adjacent to the Lahore SOS village, I went there for a visit just to see what it all was. It overwhelmed me, and I was so emotional because, you know, when you are a mother, you really can relate to the problems which these children are facing.
True.
And when I saw how welcoming they were, they came up and hugged me. I was a new person.
So sweet.
I mean, it really touched my heart, and I thought that it would be a mission for me to somehow try to maybe change maybe a little part of their lives.
Wow.
And this is how I see my job. When you talk about the grievances or how directly we can hear about it, it's a completely open door policy for us.
Oh.
Anybody can come walk in into my office. We have every village has a box, and it's locked. And if any child, any staff member, anybody has any complaint, any grievance, they put something in the box, and then it's every day it's taken out. I get anonymous emails all the time informing me about if there is any problem or if any child has some issue. So there are ways and means where we do cater, and of course our child safeguarding policy is absolutely wonderful.
Okay.
In fact, we are just during our training session, and we had a child safeguarding training session.
Mm-hmm.
So it's amazing how we are sort of.
And it's wonderful that how you're actually, you know, deep down looking after each and every aspect of grooming a child and nurturing a child, and it's wonderful. But now over here, you know, there are two things which are on my mind, and that is because, you know, there was this time 2 years ago where we went to Kashmir Orphanage Relief Trust as well, where, you know, we were stunned by the kind of facility provided to the children. And while we were there, so we kind of talked about how holistically you really need to make sure that you're investing into a child as well, not just school, not just clothing, not just food, but how he or she would someday want to kind of go out shopping, you know, or not to wear older clothes, but rather wear new clothes on Eid or whatever occasion it may probably be, because the children would definitely come from all walks of life. You know, some might be Christians, some might be Muslims, you know, so and we have an open door policy for that too, alhamdulillah. That's what I assume.
Right.
But now what I need to ask you is that when, you know, the children are growing, they obviously have these, they fantasize, they want to go to shopping malls, they want to shop, they want to have toys, cars, and do whatever the kids are doing. So what does SOS do to make sure that all of those
needs are met,
khwahishat,
yes,
you know, that's how I want to put it, are being fulfilled of all of those children, so that while when they grow up, they don't think that, you know, that there was any part of their childhood which was left behind.
Right. So I would at this point, first of all, let you know that we have been blessed by our wonderful supporters and donors. There is just one call we make and everything happens.
It's done.
So, you know, our children are blessed that way. We do get a lot of donations, a lot of support that way from our own local Pakistani community. And we make up for that. I think you are very right that every child has this sense of maybe at some point deprivation, that okay, if he's or she is doing this or she or he has that, why not me? But we do try to maximize on that, and we do try to provide that.
And it's wonderful. And you know, just before we actually kind of started the interview, you told us that, you know, there are 17 different projects you're heading.
Yeah.
So, you know, villages might be one.
Yes.
So what are the other 16?
So 17, we are present in 17 cities,
okay,
but we have over 60 projects working in these 17 cities. So basically, obviously, first and foremost is the village, children's village, where all these orphan children come and live. Then we have also the concept of youth homes, because as soon as the child, as the boy reaches adolescence, due to cultural and religious
matters,
exactly, we need to separate them. So those are our associated projects. And then we have schools. We all the children of SOS go to the schools established by SOS. They are called Herman Minor schools. But because the schools are built of capacity of 500 or 1500 children, we take underprivileged community children also who come and enroll. In fact, that is a major majority of that. So we are also taking care of our children as well as the underprivileged community children in the education sector.
Wow.
Super. Because, well, that is definitely the need of the hour. When we talk about out-of-school children who are on the streets, it was 22 million when PTI came into being, but then a pandemic hit. I'm pretty sure we don't have the latest stats, but it's beyond 22 million for that matter. So thank you for dealing with them as well. But now, don't you feel like, and please don't think of it as a hard question, but when we talk about mainstreaming, someone who had finally the privilege to get into SOS Village and have a family, they must be really happy with it, because otherwise the reality of their life would be different.
That's right.
But in terms of mainstreaming, what if they told you, I don't want to go to this school, Herman Minor school, I want to go to probably another private school, or, you know, our public school for that matter.
Where every other kid goes, they need to go there.
Yeah, do they have an option if they come up with the suggestion?
So we do have all our children who are residing at SOS, they do go to Herman Minor schools until matriculation.
Great.
But after that, they have, and they have been all the time, cases where they have opted to go into colleges, universities, private colleges and universities, if they meet the merit criteria.
Wow.
And I am proud to say that many, many have already done that. They are, mashallah, enrolled into master's programs. Some are doing PhDs.
Wow.
Some of our wonderful children have been commissioned Air Force Army
wow.
officers.
Wow. No way. Wow.
These are success stories, which Mashallah. We are absolutely, and you know, we are so proud of these. Coming from the backgrounds that they have come from, they have been able to overcome all these obstacles and mashallah are doing very well in their lives.
And that's something which I wanted to kind of congratulate you and your entire team and for all of those people who've been working, because SOS has existed over here in Pakistan for the last 47 years, ladies
yes.
and gentlemen. So imagine there might be a lot of people. And right at the beginning, we showed you that report where we did talk about how, you know, they kind of look after each and every need of theirs, may it be getting married, may it be getting a job, may it be, you know, getting enrolled into a university. And it's just superb and perfect that alhamdulillah, you know, God forbid if your parents weren't around, you know, so in the form of your spiritual parents, you have people at SOS as well, which I believe is wonderful. But for all of those people who are watching our program today in 46 different countries, what would you say, how can they donate? You know, if there's any links, websites or phone numbers, please give them away as well, because everybody wants to chip in such an act of piousness.
Definitely. And sorry, please do add also the eligibility criteria for whoever can be a part
of. So let me go to the eligibility criteria first, the admission criteria. Everything is on our website. All the information related to admission criteria, how they can donate, everything is there. But for our audience today, I'm going to repeat it. We take a newborn to 10-year-old children who are, of course, fully orphaned.
Even newborns?
Well, they are very
abandoned.
Less who in numbers they come, but we do take, we do cater to that. And they come to us from extended families. They do bring us those children. Obviously, their both parents are deceased, and that is an automatic criteria. Then we do have some, and I would say that is the majority of children are categorized as social orphans, where the fathers have passed away, but the mothers have remarried and the new stepfathers are not able to or not willing to take up those. So those are the social orphans.
All right. Okay.
So this is somewhat the admission criteria, and for being able to help or give back to society, for people, for Pakistani audience, I would say please come to all our villages. Our doors are open. You can donate through sponsorship. You can donate through any means. We take donations in kind. And of course, for overseas Pakistanis, please visit our website. All information.
And the website is?
www.sos.org.pk.
Wow, wonderful. Thank you very much, Ms. Saba Faisal, for being with us. Lovely to be in conversation. And please continue to strive for excellence. Wonderful.
Inshallah. Thank you so much.
It's our pleasure, ladies and gentlemen. We really hope that you are taking something very substantial away from this show, because I think we are definitely. Tomorrow, inshallah, same time, we'll see you again. Till the next time, take care. 1, 2, 3. Good morning.
Morning.